Just to be clear, going back to Senator Graham's line of questioning, you helped draft the provision stripping the courts of jurisdiction, which was struck down by the Supreme Court in Hamdan, and you weren't involved in the drafting of the McCain section of the bill on the Taney Treatment Amendment.
Senator, that wouldn't fit quite with my recollection.
Please.
My recollection is that Senator McCain and Senator Graham wrote the legislation with input from the Department of Defense and the Department of Justice and a whole lot of others besides. And I was one voice among a great many. And that in terms of when it was struck down, Hamdan held that the Detainee Treatment Act didn't apply retroactively, it only applied prospectively, and then several years later, gosh, I want to say it was 2008 maybe, the court came back around in Boumediene.
So what I'm driving at, though, is the McCain section relative to cruel, inhuman, and degrading treatment. And I assume, or I hope you've had a chance to take a glance at the emails that Senator Feinstein gave you. You said in your email you wanted a signing statement to the effect that the view is that McCain is best read as essentially codifying existing interrogation policies. So what interrogation policies did you think the McCain Amendment was essentially codifying?
Senator, I haven't had a chance to look at that. I'm sorry, I scarfed down a sandwich over the break, and I will be happy to read it, but I'm not sure what I can answer you here sitting off the top of my head. It was 12 years ago, and I'm doing the best I can with my recollection.
I'm trying to get this leap from your memory of this email, which I understand there were 100,000 pages of email.
Exactly. Senator, I think the Department of Justice has produced something like 200,000 pages of stuff.
I will concede that point, but your lack of memory at the moment, and contrast that with your clear statement that you believe that the McCain bill, which I supported, outlawed waterboarding.
I sitting here, that would be my understanding, Senator.
The problem with what I've just described is when you were talking about a signing statement, waterboarding was still happening, and you were saying in your email, I want to essentially codify existing interrogation policy. There's an inconsistency there, which we're going to have to wait to the second round to resolve.
Okay.
Let me read something to you and ask you for a reaction. Is a statement that was made about 8 days ago by a congressman named Steve King of Iowa. And here's what he said. You cannot rebuild your civilization with somebody else's babies. You've got to keep your birth rate up and that you need to teach your children your values. In doing so, you can grow your population, you can strengthen your culture, you can strengthen your way of life. The reaction to that statement was overwhelming. Civil rights leader Congressman John Lewis called it bigoted and racist. Republican House Speaker Paul Ryan said he clearly disagreed with King's comments, went on to say the speaker clearly disagrees and believes America's long history of inclusiveness is one of its great strengths. What would your reaction to that statement be?
Senator, I can talk about my record. And I can tell you that as a federal judge, when a defendant comes to court with an allegation that the sentencing judge made improper comments based on his ethnicity, me and my colleagues and I, have removed that judge from the case. I can tell you that when an immigration lawyer fails to provide competent counsel time and time again, I've sent him to the bar for discipline. Okay. I can tell you that when it comes to access to justice, I've written on this topic. I've worked on this topic for the last 6 years together with many wonderful people on the Rules Committee trying to make our civil litigation system cheaper and faster because it takes too long for people to exercise their Seventh Amendment liberties. And I can tell you, together with my colleagues, when we found that the level of representation of inmates on death row was unacceptable in our circuit, a whole bunch of us, I can't take too much credit, tried to do something about it. I can tell you that when prisoners come to court pro se handwritten complaints and I see something that might be meritorious in them, I appoint counsel. That's my record, Senator.
Can you describe your relationship with Professor John Fennis?
Sure. He was my dissertation supervisor.
When did you first meet him?
Well, whenever I went to Oxford, so it would have been 1992. Well, it could have been two or three, somewhere in there.
And what was his relationship with you or you with him?
He was my dissertation supervisor, and I would describe that as a relationship between teacher and student, and he was a very generous teacher, particularly generous with his red ink on my papers. I remember sitting next to the fire in his Oxford office. It's like something out of Harry Potter. And he always had a coal fireplace burning, and sometimes whether I was being raked over the coals. He did not let an argument that I was working on go unchallenged from any direction.
So that was over 20 years ago that you first met him?
Whatever it is, yes.
Do you still have a friendship or relationship with him?
Last time I saw him, I know I saw him when he retired, and there was a party held in his honor, and I remember seeing him then, and that was a couple of years ago.
Did he know you were from Colorado?
I don't know. It must have at some point come out in our conversations. Mm-hmm. I don't know.
And do you recall saying some words of gratitude for his help in writing your book?
He did not write my book, He did not help write my book. I wrote my book. I certainly expressed gratitude to my dissertation supervisor in a book that's basically my dissertation.
I think you were quoted as saying in 2006, you thanked Fennis for his, quote, kind support through draft after draft.
And there were a lot of drafts, Senator. I mean, golly, that was a very tough degree. That was the most rigorous academic experience of my life, and I had to pass not just him, but an internal examiner and an external examiner, and that was hard. That was hard.
In 2011, when Notre Dame ran a symposium to celebrate his work, you recalled your study under him, and you said, quote, it was a time when legal giants roamed among Oxford spires.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
You called him one of the great scholars.
Well, and Oxford has a stable, and it's part of the reason why it was such a privilege. I mean, out here as a kid from Colorado, and I got a scholarship to go to Oxford. I'd never been to England, to Europe before. And at Oxford at that time, they had John Fennis, Joe Raz, Ronald Dworkin. H.L.A. Hart was even still alive then.
So let me, if I can, read a couple statements from Professor Fennis. In 2009, Professor Fennis wrote about England's population. He said England's population had, quote, largely given up bearing children at a rate consistent with their community's medium-term survival. He warned they were on a path to, quote, their own replacement as a people by other peoples more or less regardless of the incomer's compatibility of psychology, culture, religion, or political ideas and ambitions, or the worth or viciousness of those ideas and ambitions. He went on to say, quote, European states in the early 21st century move into a trajectory of demographic and cultural decay, population transfer and replacement by a kind of reversed colonization. Had you ever read that before?
Nope.
Had you heard it before?
Nope, not to my recollection.
Could you distinguish what he said with what Congressman Steve King said?
Senator, I'm not here to answer for Mr. King or for Professor Fennis.
But I'm asking your reaction to these things. Do you feel that what Professor Fennis wrote about purity of culture and such is something that we should condemn or congratulate?
Senator, before I expressed any view on that, I'd want to read it. And I'd want to read it from beginning to end, not an excerpt. And Senator, I've had a lot of professors. I've been blessed with some wonderful professors. And I didn't agree with everything they said, and I wouldn't expect them to agree with everything I've said.
Well, let me ask you this specific one. It was 1993, and you were at Oxford, and this is when you believe you first met this professor. Professor Finnis was tapped by the then Colorado Solicitor General, Timothy Timkovich, to help defend a 1992 state constitutional amendment that broadly restricted the state from protecting gay, lesbian, and bisexual people from discrimination. During the course of the deposition which he gave in support of that effort, Finnis argued that antipathy toward LGBT people, specifically toward gay sex, was rooted not just in religious tradition, but Western law and society at large. He referred to homosexuality as bestiality in the course of this as well. Were you aware of that?
Senator, I know he testified in the Romer case. I can't say sitting here I recall the specifics of his testimony or that he gave a deposition.
I guess the reason I'm raising this is a man who apparently had an impact on your life, certainly your academic life, and I'm trying to figure out where we can parse his views from your views, what impact he had on you as a student, what impact he has on you today with his views.
Well, and I guess, Senator, I think the best evidence is what I've written. I've written over, written or joined over 6 million words as a federal appellate judge. I've written a couple of books. I've been a lawyer and a judge for 25 or 30 years. That's my record. And I guess I'd ask you respectfully to look at my credentials and my record. And some of the examples I've given you are from my record about the capital habeas work, about access to justice. I've spoken about overcriminalization publicly. Those are things I've done, Senator.
And what about LGBTQ individuals?
Well, Senator, there are. What about them?
Well, the point I made is
they're people.
Oh, and of course. You know, but what you said earlier was that you have a record of speaking out, standing up for those minorities who you believe are not being treated fairly. Can you point to statements or cases you've ruled on relative to that class?
Senator, I've tried to treat each case and each person as a person, not of this kind of person, not of that kind of person, a person, equal justice under law. It is a radical promise in the history of mankind.
Does that refer to sexual orientation as well?
Senator, the Supreme Court of the United States has held that single-sex marriage is protected by the Constitution.
Judge, would you agree that if an employer were to ask female job applicants about their family plans, but not male applicants, that would be evidence of sex discrimination prohibited by Title VII of the Civil Rights Act?
Senator, I'd agree with you. It's highly inappropriate.
You don't believe it's prohibited?
Senator, it sounds like a potential hypothetical case that might be a case or controversy I might have to decide, and I wouldn't want to prejudge it sitting here at the confirmation table. I can tell you, it would be inappropriate.
Inappropriate. Do you believe that there are ever situations where the cost to an employer of maternity leave can justify an employer asking only female applicants and not male applicants about family plans?
Senator, those are not my words, and I would never have said them.
I didn't say that. I asked you if you agreed with this statement.
And I'm telling you I don't.
Thank you. In Wang versus Kansas State, the case involved a cancer-stricken professor. You wrote an opinion that noted that EEOC guidance commands deference, quote, only to the extent its reasoning actually proves persuasive. EEOC's enforcement guidance on pregnancy discrimination provides as follows. Because Title VII prohibits discrimination based on pregnancy, employers should not make inquiries into whether an applicant or employee intends to become pregnant. The EEOC will generally regard such an inquiry as evidence of pregnancy discrimination where the employer subsequently makes an unfavorable job decision affecting a pregnant worker. Do you find this instruction to be persuasive?
Senator, there's a lot of words there, and if you're asking me to parse them out and give you a legal opinion, and I fear that you may be, I'd respectfully say I'd have to study it in the course of a judicial case.
Well, let me bring it right down to the operative words. Whether employees should or should not make inquiries into whether an applicant or employee intends to become pregnant.
Senator, it sounds like you're asking me about a case for a controversy, and I, with all respect, when we come to cases and controversies, a good judge will listen. Socrates said the first virtue of a good judge is to listen courteously. and decide impartially.
I think you know why I'm asking these questions.
No, I don't.
The reason I'm asking is because about your views on pregnancy, women in the workplace, is because two of your former students from legal ethics and professionalism class last spring wrote to this committee to say how troubled they were by your comments in an April 19th class. It was a gender-targeted discussion regarding the hardship to employers of having female employees who may use maternity benefits. One of these students signed her name publicly to her letter, which is a pretty brave thing to do. That student didn't just make this issue up after you were nominated. Last night, the University of Colorado Law School confirmed that she had voiced her concerns with administrators shortly after your April 19th class, and also confirmed that the administrators told her they would raise this matter with you, though they never actually did so. When we receive information like this, which raises questions about your views and conduct on important issues, I want to get to the bottom of it. I mentioned that to you yesterday in my opening statement, that I would be bringing this up. So I just want to ask you to confirm, did you ask your students in class that day to raise their hands if they knew of a woman who had taken maternity benefits from a company and then left the company after having a baby?
No, Senator, and I'd be delighted to actually clear this up.
Please.
Because the first I heard of this was the night before my confirmation hearing. I've been teaching legal ethics at the University of Colorado for 7 or 8 years. It's been a great honor and pleasure. I teach from a standard textbook that every professor, well, I don't know if every professor, a number of professors at CU and elsewhere use. It's an excellent textbook, Professors Lerman and Schrock. One of the chapters in the book confronts lawyers with some harsh realities that they're about to face when they enter the practice of law. As you know, and I know, we have an unhappy and unhealthy profession in a lot of ways. Lawyers commit suicide at rates far higher than the population. Alcoholism, divorce, depression are also at extremely high rates. Young lawyers also face the problem of having enormous debts when they leave law school. And that's a huge inhibition for them to be able to do public service, like you and I are so privileged to be able to do. We talk about those things. There is one problem in the book, and I'd be happy to share with you the book and the teacher's manual so you can see for yourself, Senator, which asks the question, and it's directed to young women, because sadly, this is a reality they sometimes face. The problem is this. Suppose an older partner woman at the firm that you're interviewing at asks you if you intend to become pregnant soon. What are your choices as a young person? You can say yes, tell the truth, the hypothetical is that it's true, and not get the job, and not be able to pay your debts. You can lie, maybe get the job, you can say no. That's a choice too, it's a hard choice. Or you can push back in some way, shape, or form. And we talk about the pros and the cons in a Socratic dialogue so that they can think through for themselves how they might answer that very difficult question. And Senator, I do ask for a show of hands, not about the question you asked, but about the following question. And I ask it of everybody. How many of you have had questions like this asked of you in the employment environment? An inappropriate question about your family planning. And I am shocked every year, Senator, how many young women raise their hand. It's disturbing to me. I knew this stuff happened when my mom was a young practicing lawyer, graduating law school in the 1960s. At age 20, she had to wait for a year to take the bar. I knew it happened with Justice O'Connor. Couldn't get a job as a lawyer when she graduated Stanford Law School and had to work as a secretary. I am shocked it still happens every year that I get women, not men, raising their hand to that question. Thank you for the opportunity to clarify that, Senator.
And I wanted to give you that opportunity. I told you yesterday we'd get to the bottom of this and I'd give you your chance to tell your side of the story. You made a point yesterday of talking about your four heroes, and one of them was Justice Jackson. And I went back to look at some of his cases. I just know of him. I don't know much about him. And I found his dissent in Korematsu. And this was a case which I thought was fascinating because his dissent was not that long, but it had an impact. It was profound. The question, of course, was the military orders in the United States on the treatment of Japanese Americans. Fred Korematsu was caught up in it and was basically told he had no choice. He had to go off to the internment camp, and that whole military directive was challenged in this case. And it was interesting that it was upheld in an opinion by Justice Black, but among the dissenters was Robert Jackson. In his dissent, he said some things that I thought were pretty interesting, and I'd like to ask your thoughts on them. He gave a constitutional condemnation of what he considered the military's racist exclusion orders, but what he articulated in the second half of the opinion is what I'd like to ask you about. He really raised a question about the role of the courts, even the Supreme Court, in time of war, in time of fear, when it came to military orders, and whether the courts and the Constitution were up to it. That was really an amazing challenge to us as a nation of laws. So what do you think about the role of the court challenging the military or the commander-in-chief in time of war? And as Senator Graham reminded us, many people believe we are at war, and I believe you confirm that as well. Are we up to it in terms of constitutional protection and the role of the court?
We better be. Senator, a wise old judge, kind of like Judge Johnson, you're going to hear from. He's going to come talk to you from Colorado, and a hero of mine. Know me since I was taught. He taught me that the test of the rule of law is whether the government can lose in its own courts and accept the judgment of those courts. That doesn't happen everywhere else around the world. We take it for granted in this country. It's a remarkable blessing from our forefathers. And it is a daunting prospect as a judge to have to carry that baton. And to do it on the Supreme Court of the United States, it's humbling, that prospect, to me. I pledge to you that I will do everything I can to uphold the Constitution and the laws as a good judge should at all times.
Let me ask you about another case that's been referred to. Yesterday, many of us left Al Madden sitting in that truck. It was about 3 in the morning on I-88 west of Chicago. I've driven it many times. It was in January. The temperature in the cab was 14 degrees below zero. He had no heater in his cab. His dispatcher had told him, sit tight. You either drag that trailer with the frozen brakes behind you out onto that highway or you wait. And so he waited for hours, and finally, feeling numb and life-threatening, he unhitched the trailer and took his tractor to a place for some gas and to warm up, and then returned to it when they fixed it. 7 different judges took a look at those facts and came down on Al Madden's side, except for one, you. Why?
Senator, this is one of those that you take home at night. The law said that the man is protected and can't be fired if he refuses to operate an unsafe vehicle. The facts of the case, at least as I understood them, was that Mr. Madden chose to operate his vehicle, to drive away, and therefore wasn't protected by the law. He would be protected if he refused to operate, but he chose to operate.
But you
now,
know,
Senator,
you know the distinction, though, because his dispatcher had told him, don't leave unless you drag that trailer.
Right.
And he said, I can't do it. It's, you know, the brakes are frozen. And they went out there at 14 below and unhitched that trailer, he thought, because he was in danger. And when you wrote your dissent in this, you said it was an unpleasant option for him to wait for the repairman to arrive.
I said more than that, Senator.
I know you did. And you went on to say that you thought that the statute, which we thought protected him, you said, especially ends in the ephemeral and generic phrase, health and safety. You went on to write, after all, what under the sun, at least at some level of generality, doesn't relate to health and safety? We had a pretty clear legislative intent for a driver who feels he's in danger of his life, perhaps, and you dismiss it. The only one of seven judges, and say, no, you're fired, buddy. And you know, he was blackballed from trucking because of that. Never got a chance to drive a truck again.
Senator, all I can tell you is my job is to apply the law you write. The law as written said that he would be protected if he refused to operate. And I think by any plain understanding, he operated the vehicle. And if Congress wishes to revise the law, I wrote this. I said it was an unkind decision. I said it may have been a wrong decision, a bad decision. But my job isn't to write the law, Senator. It's to apply the law. And if Congress passes a law saying a trucker in those circumstances gets to choose how to operate his vehicle, I will be the first one in line to enforce it. I've been stuck on the highway in Wyoming in a snowstorm. I know it's involved. I don't make light of it. I take it seriously. But, Senator, this gets back to what my job is and what it isn't. And if we're going to pick and choose cases out of 2,700, I can point you to so many in which I have found for the plaintiff in an employment action or affirmed a finding of an agency of some sort for a worker or otherwise. You know, I'd point you to, for example, WD Sports or Casey, Energy West, Crane, Simpson versus CU. It's just a few that come to mind that I've scratched down here on a piece of paper.
Judge, we up here are held accountable for our votes. And I've been in Congress for a while, and I've cast a lot of them. Some of them I'm not very proud of. I wish I could do it all over again. I made mistakes. But your accountability is for your decisions, as our accountability is for our votes. And if we're picking and choosing, it's to try to get to the heart of who you are and what you will be if you're given a chance to serve on the Supreme Court. I'd like to go, if I can, for just a moment, to this famous case, which you and I discussed at length, Hobby Lobby. I still struggled all the way through this, and it was a lengthy decision, with trying to make a corporation into a person. Boy, did the court spend a lot of time twisting and turning and trying to find some way to take RFRA and say that Congress really meant corporations like Hobby Lobby when they said person. It was dictionary law and so many different aspects of this. What I was troubled by, and I asked you then, I'll ask you again. When we are setting out, as that court did, to protect the religious liberties and freedom of the Green family, the corporate owners, and their religious belief about what's right and wrong when it comes to family planning, and the court says that's what will decide it, what the Green family decides when it comes to health insurance, you made a decision that thousands of their employees would not have protection of their religious beliefs and their religious choices when it came to family planning. You closed the door to those options in their health insurance. And by taking your position to the next step, to all those who work for closed-end corporations in America, 60 million people had their health insurance and their family planning and their religious belief denigrated, downsized to the corporate religious belief, whatever that is. Did you stop and think when you were making this decision about the impact it would have on the thousands and thousands, if not millions, of employees if you left it up to the owner of the company to say, as you told me, there's some kind of family planning I like and some I don't like?
Senator, I take every case that comes before me very seriously. I take the responsibility entrusted in me in my current position very grave. I think if you ask the lawyers and judges of the Tenth Circuit, am I a serious and careful judge? I think you'll hear that I am. I'm delighted to have an opportunity to talk to you about that decision. As you know, in RFRA, the Religious Freedom Restoration Act, Congress was dissatisfied with the level of protection afforded by the Supreme Court under the First Amendment to religious exercise. The court, in a case called Smith versus Maryland, written by Justice Scalia, said any neutral law of general applicability is fine. That's doesn't offend the First Amendment. So laws banning the use of peyote, Native Americans, tough luck, even though it's essential to their religious exercise, for example. This Congress decided that that was insufficient protection for religion. And in a bill sponsored by Senator Hatch, Senator Kennedy, Senator Schumer, when he was in the House, wrote a very, very strict law. And it says that any sincerely held religious belief cannot be abridged by the government without a compelling reason, and even then, it has to meet, has to be narrowly tailored. Strict scrutiny, the highest legal standard known in American law. Okay. I've applied that same law, RFRA and RLUIPA, their companion statutes, to Muslim prisoners in Oklahoma who seek halal meals, to Native Americans who wish to use an existing sweat lodge in Wyoming, and to Little Sisters of the Poor. Hobby Lobby came to court and said, we deserve protections too. We're a small family-held company, small number of people who own it, I mean. They exhibit their religious affiliations openly in their business. They pipe in Christian music. They refuse to sell alcohol or things that hold alcohol. They close on Sundays, though it costs them a lot. And they came to court and said, we're entitled to protection too under that law. It's a tough case. We looked at the law, and it says any person with a sincerely held religious belief is basically protected except for strict scrutiny. What does person mean in that statute? Congress didn't define the term. So what does a judge do? A judge goes to the Dictionary Act, as you alluded to, Senator. The Dictionary Act is an act prescribed by Congress that defines terms when they aren't otherwise defined. That's what a good judge does. Doesn't make it up. Goes to the Dictionary Act. And the Dictionary Act, Congress has defined person to include corporation. So you can't rule out the possibility that some companies can exercise religion. And of course, we know churches are often incorporated. And we know nonprofits, like Little Sisters or hospitals, can practice religion. In fact, the government in that case conceded that nonprofit corporations can exercise religion, conceded that. So that's the case. Then we come to the strict scrutiny side.
I don't want to cut you off.
Oh, I'm sorry.
I'm going to get in big trouble with
I don't want to get you in trouble.
Iowa here.
I think I would want you to continue your answering his question.
I'm sorry, Mr.
No,
Chairman.
No, please. No, I want you to continue.
Okay, all right. And so then you've got the religion, the first half of the test met, right? So then you go to the second half. Does the government have a compelling interest in the ACA in providing contraceptive care? The Supreme Court of the United States said, we assume yes. We take that as given. And then the question becomes, is it narrowly tailored to require the Green family to provide it? And the answer there the Supreme Court reached, and precedent binding on us now, and we reached in anticipation, is no, that it wasn't as strictly tailored as it could be because the government had provided different accommodations to churches and to other religious entities. The Greens didn't want to have to write down and sign something saying that they were permitting the use of devices they thought violated their religious beliefs. And the government had accommodated that with respect to other religious entities and couldn't provide an explanation why it couldn't do the same thing here. That's the definition of strict scrutiny. Now, Congress can change the law. It can go back to Smith versus Maryland if it wants to, eliminate RFRA altogether. It could say that only natural persons have rights under RFRA. It could lower the test on strict scrutiny to a lower degree of review if it wished. It has all of those options available, Senator. And if we got it wrong, I'm sorry, but we did our level best, and we were affirmed by the United States Supreme Court. And it's a dialogue, like any statutory dialogue, between Congress and the courts.
Thank you, Judge, and thank you, Mr. Chairman.